pretty unusual, actually. I think I realized it last year after we got beat by Fair State, to be honest with you. You know, I go back to last year's game, and or 2 years ago, I guess now, but it was the fourth quarter, and it was a one-score game, and we had to get off the field defensively, and we just couldn't get the third down stop that we needed. They eventually scored, and the score was not indicative of the actual game itself. I think we ended up losing by a couple scores. But I just knew at that point, with the guys we had coming back, the type of leadership we had, I felt like the sky was the limit for this group.
I would say in the summer after losing to Fair State in the semi, it brought a lot of us together. We all focused and grind and trained to try to be a better you, better version of you. And the talent was always there. We just had to trust each other and play together.
I would say at the beginning of the season, we knew that we had the talent, we had the guys, like the schemes, the personnel to be good. And that was kind of our thought going into it. But I would say once we started clicking on offense and defense and even special teams, once we started putting all the pieces together midway through the year, I say that's when we became the best we could be.
I mean, we knew we had potential to be really good back in the beginning. We always talk about it, but we have the guys. We just kind of need to put it all together and hope, like, keep it together. And I think kind of the part, once we started to trust each other, like we kind of felt as an offense, the first couple of games were kind of rough. We knew we could be better and we were frustrated with it. And then we started just trusting each other, and it kind of just has a snowball effect in a good way. It just kind of kept building and building and built on it all the way through.
I mean, I feel like coaches have said it too, and I'm going to say it again. It's not any game that was this year. It was losing to Ferris State last year and realizing that we know it's coming back, and we know we have unfinished business. We know that we could have won that game against Ferris State a couple years back, but we just couldn't capitalize on the plays. And coming back and going through and playing all those games, we knew that we had to go 1-0. We really took the 1-0 vision to a real, real deadline, real heart. So we really had to take care of business week in and week out.
The whole idea and mindset that, you know, you're not gonna outwork me and you're not gonna out-tough me is kind of what separates us from, like, other teams. And especially when it gets later, like in the fourth quarter, you know, that kind of gives us that edge and separates us, you know.
The teamwork, I would say, talent could go really far with teamwork. There's not a lot of people that wants to do their own job, do their own thing. Not a lot of people that care that they're making a play. We're all just doing our job and playing together. That's really was the big thing.
I think trust in you know, each other, coaches, that's huge. Like when things weren't going our way, we weren't the ones that are pointing fingers at each other, you know. Someone's doing that, you gotta call them out, let them know about it and be like, hey, we need to be positive about it. And just the mental training aspect of what we do, just trying to remain positive is just a huge factor of the game. Like momentum swings either way, but if you keep it always a positive mindset that you're gonna get yours next, it's gonna help you in the long run.
It's just the cohesion of our entire team. Everybody is so unselfish here. Nobody really cares who makes the play on offense. Nobody cares who makes the play on defense. We just want to win football games, and that's what separates us apart.
Cause I'm
The best player of the year would be, in my opinion, against Duluth, homecoming, first player of the game. Our offense go out there and score with 70-some yards, touchdown right away from the jump, and it got the crowd going, it got the defense going, and got everyone going. It really set the tempo for the game.
For me, it's kind of hard. You know, since playing offensive line, it's every play kind of comes one at a time with it, and it's just, I like to run the ball, so anytime we get to run the ball, I love pulling, so power would probably be, anytime I got to run power would be my good play call.
I guess for me it would be the Tex right, we went 81 snare. Dropped back, sprinted out to the left, and then was getting dragged down, but you know, Tyler Schmidt was wide open and then threw it to him in the end zone against Concordia, so.
There's a lot of energy. I think that would be the best way to describe it, is whether it's the fans or within ourselves and the coaches, everyone is super positive, really upbeat, really excited to play football.
You feel the energy from the stands, but seeing it like come down to you while you're on the field is something special.
You know, knowing that you're at the Blake and that you're playing, you know, on that all natural grass field, and you know, You know, it's a good feeling, and it's an exciting feeling that really gets everybody pumped up.
Blakesley is one heck of a place to play in. From the fans literally sitting on top of you, those stands and how they come down, the loud roars that you hear when you make big plays. I mean, it's just the tradition that's come and gone on that field and everything. It means a whole lot to play on Blakesley.
It's a fun atmosphere, especially like the Harvest Bowl. I have a lot of family come for that one. So that one, it's like, especially this year, now we walk through all like the people and the tailgating, and like, you know, you're trying to kind of, you know, tune it out, but it's kind of fun to hear and just listen to them cheering you on, is kind of know that they're there to support you. So it's just kind of like knowing that like everyone there is there to support you and wants you to do your best.
The Duluth game, honestly, you know, the reason being is, yeah, we dominated them, but there was a lot of hype that was coming up towards the game, you know, and a lot of people, some people had us winning, some people had Duluth winning, you know, and it was a top 10 matchup or something like that. And, you know, all the build up before the game, you know, everybody's talking about how close it's going to be. And I think after that game, it kind of set the tone for what kind of team that we were. And I think that was like our biggest turn up, you know, of the year.
Off the top of my head, the Duluth one. I mean, that game came in with so much hype. Like, just that whole day, it felt like we had just so much more to do. Like, we had to breakfast with like the old alumni, and like you kind of understood all of a sudden what this game means to them, as in like they've been done playing for 10 years, but they came back. This is when they see each other again, and it kind of is like, now being a senior, it's like, well, that'll be me or in 10 years from now eventually, and just kind of that same feeling, them coming back and then going out there with it being a top 10 game and just, as you know, just putting the foot down and taking it easy.
I think what really changed the stride for the season was that opening play. Ryan Schlichty, the Shane Zylstra down the sideline in Duluth, opening play, 80 yards, touchdown. Best play all year.
I would have to say the opening play against Duluth, where we threw a bomb to Shane and Shane takes it to the house. That was a great way to, that was a big game for us, and it was a great way to start the game.
Well, I think there's probably two other moments. The Duluth game was a big time game. I think the outcome was certainly a big time win for us. I think it was a 40-45 point margin of victory. But the nature in which that we played, I think, was really dominant. A lot's been made about that first play of the game, and I think that set the tempo with Ryan connecting with Shane down the sideline and just that feeling. Because the last time we played those guys, we had some similar success throwing the football vertical. And to come out and establish that right off the bat, I think it's two things. Number one, it gave us a huge shot in the arm. And number two, it made them kind of doubt themselves a little bit, like, here we go again. And I thought defensively we made some key stops, and offensively we scored, and that's what you have to do. Really a limited amount of years that we throw the deep ball. Sample on the near side. That's who he's looking for. Sample.
The blitz coming.
He's looking to Zylstra for the post corner. Zylstra rolls his head. Count it. Shane Zylstra having himself a 50 touchdown. Second and 10. They're going to hand it to Sullivan, man. He got it. Third and 10 for Ikawa. Wow. Pressure. Big bull rush on the outside. Ikawa does a nice job to get out of it. Oh, Ikawa hands off to Gunn, who cuts it back. Ikawa throws a big ball. Here goes Gunn. Still alive, and he's tackled. Field. He'll stay out there. He's been out there the whole drive. Play action. They got a man in the flats. Caught. Diving. And touchdown. Late for long. The time you get an option out of this. So they're going to throw this one downfield. A single coverage. Long to that. It's going to be intercepted. The receiver wasn't looking. It's a big dog. First and goal at the one. Nate Gunn, there it is. His 41st of his career.
I think somehow here comes the blitz.
Under pressure, stepping up, and he's going to go down. Chased around by Taramina, the running back. Ikawa looking down the field, wide open is Zylstra at the 30 and out of bounds near the 25-yard line, still 18. 6'6 and 6'5 on the left side. Ikawa, he's going to pull it out, he's looking for Gunn, but Ikawa's going to have to run it. He's got some wheels, and he's got six. J.D. Ikawa from Minnesota State, here's Gunn, following that offensive line right up the linebacker. So he's a really nice addition this year as the quarterback's going down. Jordan Bergman gets there, his third sack of the season. Olsen, plenty of time in the pocket, now going to move outside of it. He's in some trouble. He's going to go down, throws it, but Schlichty looking, oh man, wide open, it's Zylstra. You're not tackling him in the open field, my goodness. The big man back home in the end zone. Off. Look at this run. There it is. See you later. Caleb Sleezer was a bullet through the line.
People need to understand is you're on a play at Minnesota State. You have to understand that personal goals, personal aspirations, and you know, agendas are something that need to take a back seat to the team's focus, the team's goals, and the team's agenda.
No, that's a great question. I think the first thing is that it's what are you trying to attract, right? The way that we recruit is a very, I kind of use the term nuts and bolts type of approach. You know, we try to explain to kids, here's what the opportunity is that you have in front of you. Here's what we're all about. You know, I understand today's day and age and Twitter and those types of things and some of the things that go on with all that. We try to be very practical with the guys that we recruit, try to be very upfront with the process, try to be very honest about the process, find out how much they really love football and how much they love being a student athlete. I think, you know, recently you have a signing day and everybody gets excited about signing day, but that's kind of like wedding day. You know, you have your wedding day, but then you have the rest of the marriage, right? And so the commitment day is great, but then it's the next 4 to 5 years that you're going to be committed to the program and doing the right thing. So trying to find kids that believe in the process, that believe in getting up and working hard and getting knocked down and getting back up, I think that's critical. And if you get those kind of kids in the front end, you usually attract those kind of personalities. And so you kind of limit a lot of the issues you might have down the road with selflessness or selfishness and being self-centered and worrying about yourself. And you become more team-oriented and buying into the process, which is important.
It's quiet. Everyone listens to their own music, so everyone can zone in the way that they want to, but it's really focused. Everyone's, you know, taking those mental reps before the game to prepare to play at their best, and then right before the locker room, we do a couple like traditional things, and then everyone gets fired up to go out. And
usually, before the game, the locker room is very quiet. There's no music being played, so people can have their personal thoughts, whatever they want to do. Usually a lot of people provide headphones for themselves and everyone is focused up, looking at their notes, last minute plays, and just everyone's getting focused on going 1-0.
Usually in the locker room, pregame, it's supposed to be quiet. Usually people just wear their headphones and listen to the music. We don't have music playing all around the locker room. Everybody kind of just gets into their own zone and just mentally preparing.
Everyone has their own style of how they get ready for a game. Some are more talkative than others, some really stay to themselves, but overall there's a lot of mutual respect. We understand that people get ready for games in different ways, and so some people are really hyping themselves up and some people are just getting in the zone quietly by themselves.
Please welcome your Minnesota State Mavericks.
Thank you. Never know that everybody trying to hurt me, but I go psycho. Everything I write that I know got me bottled up like a psycho. Feel like they wanna get into me now. Feel like I'm up in the industry now. Everybody claim they're killing me. How? Feel like they wanna get into me. Wow. Hold up, I got purpose. Y'all barely scratching the surface. See when I'm penning these verses, they gonna know I got purpose.
A lot of teams have talent. We have a lot of talent. We feel like we're, you know, the most talented teams are going to win. True, but the most talented teams that work together are going to go further. And the way that it's instilled is how our kids prepare together, how they train together, and how they understand that in the game of football, you know, everyone's success is everybody else's success.
Well, I think that begins with the attitude of being unselfish, you know. The big thing for us is on defense, we play a lot of guys, and you have to be comfortable being a part of the process and being a part of the group. And if you're the kind of person that wants to be all about yourself and to pound your chest and say, look at me, that's not how we operate. And so for us, I think when kids are selfless and they do not have a selfish attitude and they care about each other and they enjoy each other and they have fun off the football field, it makes it that much easier to play that way on the football field. And I think this group was really special. If you walked into this locker room and you saw these guys interacting and playing video games and having fun and enjoying each other's company, it wouldn't surprise you they play that way on the field. Being happy for your teammates' success is really important, and I think that's something our kids really took to and did a great job with.
You know, going 1-0 every week to me is make the journey, go 1-0. And what I think about making the journey is the decisions that you make on a daily basis. That's the journey, right? That's the culture, whatever you want to call it. And that is going to help you go 1-0, right? 1-0 is not just a Saturday deal on game day. It's how you prepare on Sunday. It's how you rest on Monday. It's how you lift weights on Tuesday morning. Right, it's how you practice on Tuesday afternoon. It's how you watch film at night of your opponent or of yourself. So making the journey is doing the things necessary to get the result that you want on a Saturday. I'm going 1-0.
1-0. You know, make the journey.
Yeah, the 1-0, coach. You know, coach is really big on that, and I believe it too, wholeheartedly. I think the idea is that. This case of this past season was a tremendous example of that. You know, we played 15 games, you know, and you can't win 15 if you don't take care of 1, 2, and 3 because you don't have a chance to get there. And so every game builds, and every, you know, it's like watching a good movie. The big thrilling point of the movie is always at the end, right, after it builds to that, and I think that's what happens. But you have to take care of the 1-0 vision every week to give yourself a chance to stay in the hunt, to stay in the race, and to put yourself in position playoff-wise and all that. And so that's a really a big deal.
The 1-0 and then the family aspect of it too. The 1-0, we do it like you want to win every single rep, every single day, every single game, every single play. It kind of goes into the life. It's like you win it one thing, you continue to win, you always want to try and win it.
I would say defensively, we mind ourselves as being sharks, being mean, being vicious, being annoying, and being the big dog of everything.
Having that shark mentality, I think that took us a long way this year. And it was fun to be able to throw the fins up when we make a big play and kind of have that symbol as a uniting factor and bringing us all together and saying that, yeah, I made the individual play, but together we did it as a pack of sharks.
Well, I think, you know, any energy you have, it needs to be positive, it needs to be channeled, and it needs to be directed towards our abilities to win a football game.
Yeah, I think if you asked our defensive guys, we'd probably have a laugh about it. I have a tendency to get tighter and tighter as the week goes on, and they get looser and looser, and I think that's by design. I want them to play free, you know, play fast, you know, clear mind equals fast feet, and we want them to play hard and play fast and not worry about making a mistake. And I think that's our job as coaches, to take the brunt of the nervousness if you can do that.
Every young man on this team has to put the team first, and I think that's really important. And for them to put the passion, pride into everything that they do is really important for us to be successful. And
you let kids be themselves, but also they know that every decision that they make affects our team. So use your emotion in a positive way. Channel it to and use it as energy, and don't make it a negative deterrent. I think if kids understand, and our players understand, that you know the decisions that you make are going to affect how we do and what we do. And Coach Hoffner talks about making sure that every decision that you make is in the best interest of the team.
I'll miss the players the most, for sure. I was only here for 5 months, but in those 5 months, I made some of my best friends in my life and guys that I know that will be friends for the rest of my life. And I'm really thankful for that, really thankful for the relationships that I've made. And that's definitely what I'll miss most. Obviously, football is great, but I knew it was only going to last for a short amount of time. So the guys are what are going to last for a lot longer. So.
Garrett just said the guys, and that's true. You know, I'll miss a lot of these guys, Garrett included. He just got here, but you know, he was got along just as well as guys I've known for 5 years. So I'll miss them. I'll miss, you know, the field. I didn't even realize it was my last play on Blakeslee until, you know, a week later when I realized we were traveling already. I'm gonna miss the field, and yeah, with football, there's a lot to miss.
Here's the problem moving forward. We got this dome now, right? So we're becoming dome babies. All the advantages we had in places like Slippery Rock or playing a team like Texas A&M Commerce when the footy's a little loose, it's a little windy, it's a little cold. Years back, we played CSU Pueblo and the wind was howling. It was 16 degrees. You know, it was Minnesota weather, but now we got this dome. I don't know how tough we're going to be moving forward. I really don't. I don't know if we're going to be able to have that mantra of, you know, beating our chest and saying, hey, let's go. This is our weather. This is our time. Let's go do this. So we'll see. You know, I'll have to fight off the players and the coaches trying to go inside all the time so that we can have practice and get better. But there's also a toughness factor that you have to play in the elements. You got to practice in the elements. And it develops a mindset that really helps us. is it going to take to make the national title game in 2020? It's going to take leadership. You know, we lost a lot of leadership in 2019. The talent will always be there. That's our job as coaches, to have a substantial amount of talent that we can play at a really high level.
I'd just say it's consistency. Coming in every day, working my hardest, working my best. And that's the same with everyone, just because all the competition's getting, they're doing the same things we are, but we have to do it better.
It takes a lot. It takes a lot. It takes hard work and dedication, talented football players. It takes luck. It takes a little bit of everything. And I think, you know, you gotta control the things you can control. You know, the mantra around here of going 1-0 every day, give ourselves an opportunity to be successful, do the things we have to do, the off-season work, the preseason camp, all the things you have to do just to give yourself an opportunity. And we talk a lot about, you know, don't pray for opportunity, pray for that you're prepared when opportunity comes. And I think that's a big thing we talk about defensively, and so that when we are prepared and the opportunity is there, we can seize it.
We want it to be a gold rush, right? We want to strive for gold. It's an Olympic year. We want to finish first. They give out gold medals to the number one team in the nation. We want to be that team.
Being involved in playoff games before, and games where you fly commercial, and or you're getting on the bus and you're going 10, 12 hours, for as much work as our players and our coaches put into all of this, It's almost as a reward to be treated the way that you're treated. You get off the bus, you know, you check your bag or your ID, and then you walk right up the stairs onto a charter jet, and it's a big time feeling, and it's a lot of fun.
Going to Slippery Rock, just being in a different environment, being in Mankato, playing in a different environment, showing people that we don't win just because we play at home. We can win anywhere.
Now, after I've flown charter to Slippery Rock and then Texas, I think I only want to fly charter.
It was fun flying and doing something a little different than what we're used to.
Well, we had a good time. We had fun, you know, and then especially going, you know, over there and then winning and, you know, celebrating with them. You know, whenever you win, it's always fun to travel, so.
You know, the word that comes to mind is big time. Everything about that trip was big time, from the chartered flight, having our own travel party, getting to the hotel, beautiful hotel outside of the Pittsburgh area, you know, to be in a different time zone. I mean, silly things like that you don't think of, and all the things that go along with it. And to see the excitement of our kids' faces. I've been here for 4 years now, and I think that was our first road playoff game. So not only was it a road game, but it was on a plane, and that's unusual. And so I think from that perspective, it was a very big-time experience.
We're going to let it rip. We're going to play to win. We're going to give it all we got.
Keep playing! Just keep playing! tell you something.
We're going to Texas!
Yeah!
Hey, hey. Yeehaw! Hey. Yeehaw!
Listen, I'm speechless after all the things that we did this week and a little bit of rumblings about being a little bit this, being a little bit that. You guys played really well today.
Who's the best team in Division Two?
MSU!
Walking on that stage and I had to take a deep breath. I mean, anxiety just runs through your body and everything, anxiousness and everything. And you just got to look around and say, yeah, I'm really here and it's time to go and everything.
Oh man, it was once in a lifetime for me. I mean, I don't know about the team now, they got another chance, but for me, I knew it was probably gonna be my last chance to play a football game. So it was literally the once in a lifetime opportunity.
Just to play in it was an honor because there's only comes on two teams. There's 180, however many teams in Division II that compete for it in the beginning.
It is a true blessing. I've always dreamed of playing in a national championship and winning one too. So I know my time isn't done and I know I got more to take care of.
That's a big accomplishment. Everyone couldn't get that far, obviously. So it was a privilege and hopefully we can do it again.
To come down to it and it's just you and another team kind of standing on top of that mountain looking down at everyone like, we did it.
It was special. It's not something I'll ever, you know, downplay. Like
playing on natural grass, I have to tell you, there's nothing better for our players to play on a natural surface leading up to when it really freezes and gets cold. And then it could be an advantage for us too. With slippery footing and those kind of different things. There's a lot of variables that come into play. And we could have used some of those at the national championship game. No wind, no rain, no snow, no loose footing. Where were all of our intangibles and variables to help us win a championship? They just weren't there, right? We should have played at Blakeslee Stadium and we'd have beat West Florida like you wouldn't believe.
Thank you.
Lichty to throw. A deep shot. He's got his man. Touchdown.
My time, none of you people can tell me to stop. Lower the lights down, hand over my crown, hand over my heart. I do this for my town, I do this for my crowd. So turn me
around. He is sacked for the first time today. That is Braden Thomas, who's been playing great football for the Mavericks, the defensive end from this month.
Get in the game, your moment of fame, show them what you made of. It's time
third
that we stand
long.
Up. It's time that we man up.
He's got a man for open. Delivered on the money. It'll be first down and goal to go. Oh, he woke up through a beauty there. We've got a shootout today in Texas. And Gunn gets into the end zone for the touchdown.
Ready to rise. Don't be surprised. I'll take on the world now. My time, none of you people can tell me to stop. Lower the lights down, hand over my crown, hand over my heart. I do this for my town, I do this for my crowd. So turn me up real loud.
Cowan to the air. Here's Zylstra. Zylstra down the sideline, and it'll be first down and goal.
We know what it takes to be reaching the top. We're reaching the top. We know what it takes to be reaching the top.
Third and goal on the six. Gunn answers the call once again for the Mavericks.
We're reaching the top. We know what it takes to be reaching the top. Lower the lights down. Hand over my crown. Hand over my heart. I do this for my town. I do this for my crowd. So turn me up real loud. My time. None of you people can tell me to stop. Turning the track up, I'm never gonna back down. Hand over my heart, I do this for my town. I do this for my crowd, so turn me up real loud. My time. None of you people can tell me to stop.
Play fake, and Schlichty a post, as Zylstra in stride. Here come the Mavericks. The heat is on. It is a sack inside the 1 yard line. They'll mark him down on the one. That's Garrett Jansen. Uh-oh. Dawson has his punt partially blocked. Scoop and score. Minnesota State gets the block punt and the easy return for the touchdown. They'll go for the two-point conversion now with Ryan Schlichty. And they got it as he connects to Jalen Sample for the two-point conversion. Litio stays on his feet. That ball's free, and the Mavericks got it. First turnover of the day by West Florida.
That's how you keep playing!
Make it 7-0. It's stripped out of there. To the end zone, and it's incomplete. Let's see what the Mavericks have. Schlichty back in the game at QB. Nice job connecting with Williams. Crosses midfield. That's going to be intercepted. A big break for Minnesota State. Let's see what Cade Johnson can do with the return. Just shy of midfield, opening the door once more for Minnesota State. Schlichty escapes the pressure. He's got a lot of room to run. on the move. Throws and it is caught. No signal yet. Touchdown.
Guess who?
Got it.
If you're not going to go to Shane Zylstra, you're going to go to Justin Arnold.
Schlichty gets out of there. Stays on his feet. Not again by Arnold. My goodness, what a nice reception that was.
This is such a great throw and catch on the sideline. Look at this, goes up, catches it, secures it, makes sure you get 2 feet in bounds. That's good in the league. Too easy.
Throw and catch to Justin Arnold.
A lot of people have commented and given, you know, us as coaches a lot of feedback and saying, hey, wow, what a bunch of fighters, what a bunch of competitors, what a bunch of guys that are, you know, just giving it their all and never saying die.
Let's go! Let's go! Let's go!